All right. Thank you so much for joining us today with this product webinar. We really appreciate your time. We know that this is an extremely busy season for many of you. I wanted to go over, my name is Ben Sanders. I'm with the product marketing team here at Aspire. I just wanted to go over a few housekeeping rules as we get into the webinar. So for today's webinar, we expect our time to go for about 45 minutes. And so we'll cover a couple other topics here. We do want to invite your questions. We really do want to hear your feedback during this session. So please go ahead and use the Q&A function in Zoom, and you can follow along the questions there. Please send those our way. We'll answer questions towards the end of the presentation today and have a Q&A session. And if for some reason we're quite busy and there's lots of questions to deal with, we can address some questions directly afterwards. We do want to remind everybody that the webinar today is being recorded. So if there's something that you miss or you want to be able to share this with teammates or other folks back in the office or in the field, you can do that. We will be sending an email link out to everyone so that they'll have access to this content. And then just one last piece of information. We are going to be taking an in-Zoom poll. It's just two questions, so it's very quick. But if you do see a prompt during the presentation, we would love to get your feedback. The feedback will be specifically around this notifications feature and capability with Aspire, and we really want to continue to learn from you and see what's most important to your needs. So without further ado, we can go ahead over to the agenda and I'll turn it over to Matt Hedlund.
Hey, thanks, Ben. Appreciate being here today, having a chance to talk about notifications, some recent work we've done and delivered. So we're going to do a quick intro between myself and John here, and then we'll actually dig into notifications, just kind of what they are, differences out there, different use cases you might see in other verticals outside of landscaping, and just kind of some compliance and regulation stuff that you want to be aware of as you continue to roll out notifications to improve your customer experience. Then we'll dig into Aspire capabilities with John, kind of go through some pseudo demos of some of the opt-in workflows and potential of around the different templates and different messaging tokens you can use. And then at the end, we'll take a look into the future, and then we'll end with some Q&A. So without further ado, I'm Matt Hegeland. I'm a manager of product management here at Aspire. I've got about 15 years of software experience, joined Aspire about 18 months ago now. Most of my previous time was in a different green space, mostly in the golf software space, providing operational CRM type software to golf courses across the country. So I included some stops at NBC Sports and PGA Tour. I do work from home, not close enough to be in Chicago, but not far enough to be in Iowa, in a small farming town of Oregon, Illinois. And fun fact, used to be a scratch golfer, but my six kids have decided I am no longer a scratch golfer, but I have 7 years to get ready for the senior tour. And I'll hand it over to John.
Hi, my name's John Petcher. I'm a product manager. I work underneath Matt. I have about 10 years of experience in software, mostly in the healthcare industry, and joined Aspire about 2 years ago, actually 2 years ago yesterday to the day. So I am in St. Louis, not too far from our main office. And in my free time, I'm a very average beer league goalie. So recently upgraded to the 30 and over leagues, which I'm a big fan of, and hope to stay there for a while. So
cool. Thanks, John. So first off, kind of introduction into just general notifications and what we're going to call transactional notifications today. So what are transactional notifications? I think you'll kind of see them or experience them throughout your daily lives, probably to the point of sometime being annoying. But we'll take a look at some different examples there. So think about transactional notifications from your bank when there's account activity. You might get these reset passwords, things that your social media are generally kind of protecting your information or doing some dual factor authentication. Those types of emails are considered transactional emails. And then UPS, FedEx, those kind of real-time delivery services that are sending emails as your packages get progress throughout their system. So all of those are considered transactional emails, just to give some different examples of kind of what we're talking about today. So when we talk about transactional email, one of the first things we'll talk about is it is transactional, which typically involves an established relationship where the client or customers purchase some sort of service or product from you. One thing I'll point out here is while it's transactional in nature, you can do things that include upselling or cross-selling things, maybe links to websites, other campaigns that you want to run. Keeping those things in mind as you're thinking about how to build out your transactional email templates, I think that is something to keep in mind, that you can use that as a upselling vehicle there. Looking at that stat, revenue per email was 20% higher when people were cross-selling or upselling. Take a look at improved customer satisfaction. So according to a study by Oracle, 68% of customers expect transactional emails to be sent. I know for me, if I'm running into an issue with a website where I'm unsure if it completed successfully or there's some question, I'm usually always going immediately to my email and looking for that follow-up email so I can get a confirmation of, yes, their system processed my transaction successfully, I'm all good. I don't need to contact their support. And speaking of that, so how do you reduce incoming queries? So providing thoughtful information, thinking about call to actions, what are things that are going to reduce somebody reaching out via phone call back to the company? So we want to make sure that you're using those vehicles of information to try to prevent people from calling you, and you guys can spend more time managing your business and not dealing with the incoming inquiries. So that is email, and then we'll take a look at SMS. So again, just enhancing customer experience, streamlining operations, thinking about improved customer loyalty. So 75% of customers today in today's kind of day and age are likely to want to receive more SMS notifications from business. It's just everybody's on their phone, 24/7 access. They want instant gratification, instant notification. They want that instant kind of ingestion of information, and they want to know when something's happened with their relationship with your business. Reduce no-shows. So a study by Twilio finding that businesses that send appointment reminders see a 26% reduction in no-shows. So leveraging, giving advance notice that, hey, we're going to be here tomorrow to complete this service. Please reach out and let us know if you need to reschedule. Try to proactively get ahead of those no-shows, or where people, maybe irrigation type work where you're needing to get into a home in order to complete it, giving advance notice. Maybe something comes up, they're not able to be home anymore, they're able to reach out and let you know that, hey, I know you're trying to come here today, I'm not going to be here anymore, can we reschedule? And faster response time. So SMS messages are typically read within minutes, making them ideal for urgent, time-sensitive messages. So wanting to know that somebody just applied a certain fertilizer or something to the lawn where I don't want to let my dogs out for 30 minutes or an hour. Those types of information are probably things that I want to try to ingest immediately and what you'd want to do through those types of communication tools. Now we'll talk about transactional messaging and what it means from an opt-in standpoint. So email and SMS are both treated differently, and transactional emails or communication are different than promotional emails or communication, which we'll talk about a little bit later. But with email, transactional consent is sort of implied. I'm getting your email to complete a transaction, which just means I am okay to leverage that to send you information about the transactions or services that you've purchased, things that are going to show how things are progressing through a workflow or shipping of things, that type of workflow information is basically open if you have that email address. When we talk about SMS, there's gonna be this implied consent, which email, just like I was talking about, is just implied. I've given you my email, we're good to communicate with you. SMS is treated very differently, and it has this express consent, where express consent is required for promotional type SMS messaging. Express consent is kind of a little murky area when it comes to transactional messaging. So it says highly advised, but to an extent, I almost believe it's required with the way that SMS is regulated by the Verizons, the T-Mobiles of the world, and how the companies that provide SMS type integration of like kind of the backbone of Aspire and how we've done it. Those companies can kind of control and can say, hey, we think this number is going out of the standards. We're going to shut it down because they're not following this opt-in consent. So if there's any doubt, you want to be more cautious to reduce the risk or having issues with opt-ins. So couple joking there. I feel like sometimes it's death by opt-in. No matter where you go, you're having to agree or opt in, whether it's in person, completing a transaction at the mall. I think the other weekend I was at American Eagle and had like three different prompts to give my phone number and my email address and like agree to communication and signups, and all just there trying to buy something and get out of there as soon as I can. So sometimes it seems a little bit overbearing, but they're there to protect consumers and the privacy and security of data basically today. So when we talk about SMS compliance, there's going to be two main factors in North America, which is where our SMS works today. We're going to talk about the Telephone Consumer Protection Act. So this is something in the United States that sets rules for commercial SMS messages. And it'll read, requires businesses to obtain express consent from consumers before sending them promotional or advertising messages. So it doesn't reference transactional, but in doing our due diligence and ramping up for this effort, like I said, I believe it may not be required today, but I believe at one point it is going to be required for SMS and transactional. And if we look at Canada, Canada has a very similar Canadian Anti-Spam Legislation Act that also replicates what the same one in the United States does, where it's just enforcing and trying to provide as much protection and risk aversion for the consumers, of course, because now it's day and age, we see it all the time and hear about data being stolen, servers being hacked, what have you. So, you know, a lot of times email address and some of that kind of PII information you'll oftentimes hear is very sensitive and people want to control where that information is being stored or where it's being sent. So I put a note over there on the right-hand side that not following does or can result in significant fines and legal action. So you do want to make sure as you're rolling this out, you know, we have a backbone in place of putting as much protection in place to reduce the risk, but there are things where certain clients or certain use cases can go outside of those bounds, and that can result in something happening to your number that's used to send out SMSs, where it can be blocked or shut down by a Verizon or by all the providers. So there's definitely things before it gets to the seriousness of legal action where it could impede your communication with your clients if you do things outside of those bounds. So we mentioned it a few times, transactional versus promotional. So transactional just purely means I've signed up, I've agreed to some sort of partnership or relationship with you as a business. I bought something for you. So there's kind of this implicit agreement just through that purchase that transactional kind of like falls under. But when we look at promotional, you're going to think about those sales type emails, those sales type texts where you're getting a discount or something that's trying to solely drive you to do something with a call to action to purchase something. Those are promotional and they are handled quite differently in the grand scheme of things. And at the end, when we kind of take a look or talk about the future, promotional is something that's on our radar, but today we're just focused purely on transactional. So I just wanted to kind of clear that up. So if we take a look between email and SMS, just kind of high level, when you look at when to use email, when to use SMS, if you look at open rates, SMS is going to have a higher open rate. People have their phone on them. It's instant. They're going to get that notification, open it up. Delivery speed, not likely to get caught in some spam filters on the SMS side, where email is just a different beast. Where spam filters, you're dealing with a lot of different email servers, different logic, different security policies, depending on where email's hosted. So a lot of times, sometimes emails can get lost in the mix or the flow there. And then when we look at response rates, SMS clearly has a higher response rate. Going back again, people always have their phone on them. SMS is just always up in your face. But there are some advantages to email. If we look at the content, obviously you can do some HTML. You're not limited by characters. On the SMS side, you are limited by how many characters you can include in a message. So there's obviously some advantages there where you can produce more content, a more polished content via email, more personalization. The opt-in requirements we talked about, it's just easier to get. And then when we look at cost, to send an email, it does take a cost. It does infer that somebody's paying for that activity somewhere downstream on a server for that email to be sent. SMS is very similar, and there is a cost to it, and the cost of SMS is very much higher than the cost of emails. So I won't go into the specifics there, but just do know that there is a cost that behind the scenes, you know, we are absorbing as a company. Aspire is absorbing most of that cost today and not passing it along. So we'll talk about that here in a minute as we get into how this fits into Aspire notification. So real briefly, we'll kind of go through the background of why we did these, how it kind of fits into our product strategy. And then John will get into how to enable in Aspire some different opt-in workflows so you can kind of get a feel for what the customer, your customer would experience when using these types of notifications. We'll go through the different trigger examples we have today, wrap up with some logging. So we'll dive in here from our perspective, kind of why we did this. So these are kind of like our product values that we kind of keep as our guiding light to some of the decisions and strategic things we do from a roadmap standpoint. So as you can see here, achieving more with less, you know, notifications is going to allow you to have more automation. You're going to be able to send things without human interaction, set them up kind of like plug and play where you just kind of set and forget it. So it's going to allow you to achieve more with less, retaining more customers. We talked about the notifications creating more stickiness, giving them the information they need at the right time is going to go a long way, and then becoming more profitable. Things you can do with some of the upselling tactics we've mentioned, just other things that just make sure you're streamlined your customer experience and the communication with your customers, a big part of what we did it for. So some more background here. Email and SMS notifications today are free to all Aspire clients. So I mentioned the cost and the absorption that we're doing as a company to help you get these features in your hand. We're not passing any of those costs along to you. We're taking that, I will say, at a reasonable rate. We are monitoring usage. So if there's things or use cases that are going beyond the means or kind of going beyond those boundaries, we'll have discussions with clients. But at this point, for all intents and purposes, it is free to use and free to all Aspire clients. We choose behind the back end here as we ramped up the work, like who was going to be our providers behind the scenes. So we wanted to make sure we were focused on deliverability, scalability, compliance. So we chose kind of tier one, if you will, you know, grade A, if we're talking about beef in the Midwest here, but we chose providers that kind of are those top level providers that have very reputable services. They're scalable, they're fully compliant, they are always rolling out the latest and greatest so we can keep up with the technology and the rapidly changing environment around notifications. No setup or agreements are needed outside of Aspire. So something we're doing when we rolled this first out, we did behind the scenes, we got we did all of the due diligence and all of the hard work behind the scenes to get numbers essentially purchased for SMS. And that's something as we get new clients onto Aspire, we're doing during their implementation. So nobody's having to request this, or you're not having to come to Aspire and say, hey, I'm ready to use SMS. And we're going to tell you that, I'm sorry, it's going to take us a month to get the paperwork filed and get this SMS number generated for you. We're doing that all behind the scenes. So when you get to the next page here, when John takes over, when you go to enable it, that number is already there. It's just waiting for you to take advantage of it. And again, I put in there achieving more with less. So I really think these are game changers to help automate some of the communication and make sure that you're communicating with your clients at the right time and giving them the right information to reduce some of the inbound overhead that will take place when you're not giving them that information. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to John and get into the Aspire world.
Thanks a lot, Matt. So as Matt outlined, we have two different types of notifications. We have email and SMS. We use some third-party vendors to help us run these services. For email, we use a company called SendGrid. For SMS, we use a company called Bandwidth. So that's kind of the intermediary that we're providing all this data to that pushes those things out to the contacts that are configured. So these are pretty big companies. They do stuff for Airbnb, Spotify, Uber, all that, you know, a lot of big tech companies are using these services. And so that's what we're relying on to push these out. So from an Aspire world, we tried to make this as easy as possible to configure. So under the admin section, there's a new section called notifications. And there's two different levels of settings. So there is a system level setting that has to be enabled both for email and for SMS. And then there are also branch level settings for both email and SMS. So once you've enabled it for a system, if you're enabling email, you have to establish what we call a reply to email. So this is the address that if a customer goes to reply to an email notification that is received, this is the email address that it'll bounce back to. So this has to be something that's monitored, right? Like if not, it's just going to go out into the abyss. So that has to be set at the system level. And then you can also configure that at the branch level. So you'll see in that little modal below that when you go to enable notifications for the branch, you can also set a specific reply to for the branch itself. So if you want to have different notifications set up for different branches, they can all have their own reply to so that those emails get filtered to the right place. When it comes to SMS, as Matt alluded to, we have these auto-generated toll-free numbers that we've purchased that are assigned to each system, and that number is the same for everything. And by that, I mean for all of the branches. So when it comes to that, those are a little bit different than email because, you know, I'm sure you've seen these with automated text messages that you get about, you know, from like FedEx for delivery tracking. Those are unmonitored numbers. So if you respond to those, or if a customer responds to those, it's not monitored. It's not going to go back to you. So that's just a little bit different than how email is, where if you reply to it, it actually has a specified reply to address that response will go to. So just at a high level, you got to enable it at the system level. And then there are also branch level configurations as well. And we've also added the ability to complete a bulk action, right? So when you're managing all your different branches, you can enable and disable each notification type in bulk. You don't have to go into each individual one and set that up. So next slide. So this has to do with how you opt in for email. So again, like Matt laid out, this is a little bit more straightforward than SMS. All you have to do is go to your properties page where you manage all of your property contacts, and there's a new checkbox for email notifications. You can select a new contact, you can select an existing contact. All you have to do is check that box and make sure that they have an email address established. And then once you save, that's going to show up on the properties page. That contact's going to be configured to receive email notifications for that property, just like kind of how email invoice and billing contact work today. So from an email standpoint, very straightforward. When it comes to SMS, it's a little bit more complicated. So same kind of workflow, you go to the property page, you select your contact, you can either edit an existing one or add a new one. And then when you click the SMS notifications checkbox there at the bottom, you're gonna be asked to confirm the contact's phone number. So that's their mobile phone number from their contact record. What that's gonna do is send a alert from Aspire to our vendor to Bandwidth, and then they're going to fire off a notification to that number to get them to opt into their message. So you'll see three different icons in that case. So the yellow icon means that the contact has not yet opted into SMS, and we're either waiting on a response or they replied and said stop, like I don't want to receive text messages. If it's red, then you probably need to reach out to your Aspire contact, because that means that there was an issue sending out that confirmation text message to that user. But when it comes to the green check mark, that means we're all good. The user or the contact has received that opt-in message, and then they've responded, start, yes, I accept. I have verbally consented to receive text messages from the system. So.
And I think I think the red one too, in top of like system issues, I think we've also seen where people maybe like incorrectly typed in the mobile number, like the mobile number was not, didn't exist. So that's something to also double check, is just making sure that you enter the mobile number correctly as well.
That's correct. So this is just kind of a quick run through. And again, this might be pretty familiar to you if you already received text messages about any number of things. So This would be the initial text message just saying, hey, this system from Aspire would like to send you SMS notifications, reply start. Customer replies start, and then they get that confirmation message, right? You have verbally consented to start receiving notifications. You can reply stop at any time. And Matt has some verbiage listed out here. Start, doesn't matter. It's not case sensitive. You can reply any way you want. And then again, that green check is going to show up next to that contact so that you know, they're all good to go. They'll start receiving messages for that property. One other thing as well is that once, say you add a contact as an SMS contact on one property, and then they opt in and say, yes, I'm good to go, and you get that green check mark. If you go to add that contact to one or other or multiple other properties, they've already opted in to receive messages from that toll-free number. So they're not going to get an opt-in message every single time. Once they've opted in the first time, and we've built that link between that toll-free number and that contact, they don't need to respond to anything else. They're not going to get these messages saying opt in for each property.
Yeah. Sorry. Important note there.
And then in the case that they want to stop, same kind of thing here. They just need to reply stop to the number, and then they'll stop receiving messages. At that point, we flip that green check mark to that yellow alert icon. And again, that contact can re-enroll at any time. You don't even need to do anything in Aspire. All you need to have them do is respond start again in that same message thread, and they'll be re-enrolled.
Yeah. And I think sometimes if people delete the original thread where they want to stop it or don't know the number, you have access to the number via the admin notifications pages John was talking about, where you can actually see your toll-free number. So you could just grab that, tell them to text the number start. They could just manually type it into their phone and text start to get them back enrolled. But that is the only way to do it. The customer has to enroll themselves. You cannot override it based on some of those compliancy things that we want to make sure that you are covering.
And then we've talked so far about customer notifications. So these are notifications that go from you know, our client to your customers. We also have one notification type that is internal, and we expect to build out some additional ones as well. But these are notifications that go to your internal employees. On this example, you'll see the contact type is employee. Underneath the mobile phone number, you will now see this checkbox that says opt-in internal notifications. So all the same rules apply as far as the icons go and the opt-in process. So as soon as that box is checked and the contact is saved, that contact will get the confirmation message to enroll in text messages. But this will also allow you as our clients to send messages to your employees, crew leaders, operations managers, sales reps, things like that, so that we can automate some of those processes as well. So this isn't as fully built out as our customer notifications feature, but this is an additional workflow. And I'll go through an example of an internal notification here in just a moment. And I didn't mention this previously, but similar to this bulk action here, where you can opt in for internal notifications on the contact page. Again, this has to be a employee type or a contact type of employee. Actually, on the properties advanced search, you can also opt in a specific contact to multiple properties for messaging all at once. So we did take the time to do some bulk action as well.
Yeah, I think the key use case is like taking the primary contact or the billing contact on and making sure that checkbox is checked on all the properties where that contact's defined. So good call out there.
Alrighty. So this is an example of an internal notification opt-in. Again, this is going to be the same. Not much different here as far as opting in goes. You'll get the initial message, you'll reply start, and then you'll get that green checkbox next to the opt-in checkbox. Yep. And then I don't think I called this out either, but if you hover over that icon, whatever it happens to be, you'll get a little summary about when they've opted in or when they've opted out. So these are just some examples I want to run through of what the configuration of these notification templates actually looks like. We tried to make it you know, as reusable as possible. A lot of these parameters are similar across different types of notifications, which with some key differences. So when it comes to email, we'll talk about work ticket complete. This is the only email notification that's available right now. You can configure this a number of different ways. So you can specify specific branches, divisions, service types, services. So you can kind of customize and gear these notifications towards specific work tickets. We've also added this reply to override. So I know there was a question in the chat about being able to customize that. That is something that you can set up at the company or the branch level internally, right? So if you want to have a catch-all that just says, you know, notifications at yourcompany.com, and you know, you and your IT department can set that up, or even if you have like a Gmail account that you monitor for incoming things like that, you can set that as your reply to. The other thing you can do when you build notifications is you can override that. So say you want everything to go straight to your operations manager. Well, you can pick that from the reply to override, which is pretty cool. We have three different trigger types that are pretty important to call out as well, because there's different ways that work tickets can be completed. The primary one, obviously, is, you know, the work ticket status in Aspire gets changed to completed. But in the sub portal and in Crew Mobile, you can also mark tickets as completed. Now, as we all know, that doesn't actually change the status, but maybe you want to use this as more of a door hanger saying, hey, customer, this crew just finished their work and they're leaving the site, right? Like this is your door tag saying, hey, this is what we did today. The crew is gone for the day, as opposed to waiting for all the time entry to be validated and the ticket marked as complete in Aspire. So you can set these different triggers based on whatever you want. Maybe you want a different type of trigger for your subcontractors as well. Or maybe you actually, you just want to wait until the ticket is actually completed, everything's done before you send out that email. So that brings me to the delivery time, which there are three different options. There's instant, daily, and weekly. Those daily and weekly are more digest format. So you might want those for, you know, if you're completing multiple service, say you're installing a retaining wall, you're doing some mulching, you're doing some planting, you've got a bunch of different services that you're completing on that day. That's more of something that you might want to do as a digest format, either daily or weekly. You know, hey customer, this is what we did today, or this is what we did this week. All right. And these are just a couple of examples here. So on the left, we have an example of like an immediate delivery. This is more of like a door hanger example. Hey, we just finished this this visit at your property. We did weekly turf maintenance. Here's the materials that we used. So we have a number of different tokens that you can use to populate these emails. It's similar to how our other token repositories work in Aspire. In this case, we have a little table that we set up where it'll populate all the materials that were actually allocated to that job, which is pretty neat. So this might more apply to things like, you know, FERT applications and chemicals and things like that. On the right is more of a summary. Maybe this is something for like a business park or an HOA saying, hey, you know, here's all the work we did this week for your property. Let us know if you have any questions. Yeah, so that's kind of the difference there between the immediate and the digest. But when it comes to SMS, things are a little bit different. You have some similar parameters. Obviously, there's not the reply to override because there is no reply to, right? These are unmonitored phone numbers, but the same kind of division, service type, service breakdown, same trigger type, right? You can trigger based off of Crew Mobile complete, Subportal complete, or Aspire complete. And then this is a little bit different as well because there's a character limit, right? We're limited to how many characters we can use. These are typically more brief. But again, as you can see here, there's a number of different tokens that you can use in here as well. So Matt, if you go to the next slide, I think we have an example of what that might look like.
There you go.
Yep. So on the left, you know, this is just a quick example of the notification that the work ticket has been complete. And then an example on the right of the bounce back that you'll get if you try to respond to that. So this number is not monitored. Please reach out to the company directly. One of our newest features here is what we call visit reminders. So this is pretty self-explanatory. It's the reminder that you've got work coming up. So at the moment, our first iteration of this is limited to the day before. We plan on expanding that to multiple days before, a week before, et cetera. But right now you can send it the day before, and then you can specify a specific time that you want that to go out. So again, much of the same parameters that you have in other notification types, the difference there being the delivery time details where you want to set a specific time for this to go out. One thing with this as well is that if you are using time-based scheduling, which is another new feature, we do have additional tokens for that. So you'll see in this example that this reminder says you have a job coming up on this date at this time, which is, you know, something that wasn't available before. So if we go to the next slide, I think we'll see an example of this. So that's the initial reminder, right? So at the time that you've specified, so I think in this case, it was at 8:45 a.m. Hey, this notification is going to say you've got a visit coming up tomorrow, right? Well, what happens if after that notification goes out, that visit gets rescheduled? Well, in that case, we'll send out another notification that says this service has been rescheduled to the day that it's been rescheduled to. What if it gets canceled? Well, we have another notification that automatically goes out. This visit originally scheduled for this date and time has been canceled. Please follow up with the company if you have any questions. So we wanted to accommodate that workflow as well. We won't send that rescheduled and canceled notification if the initial one hasn't gone out yet. So that's kind of the precondition for those rescheduled and canceled notifications, is that you have to get the first one first, right? If you're making a bunch of changes on the schedule board for things that are like in the future, you don't want to be sending out a million notifications to your customers, right? So, and then the last thing I'll touch on here is what we call absentee notifications. So this is an example of an internal notification that I spoke about before. Similar parameters here. This is only an SMS notification, but what we designed this for is as an alert, essentially, to let you know if your crew is late to a job site, right? So this obviously would require time-based scheduling, because Aspire has to know what time the crew is expected to be there. You can set this by branch, by route, and then you can specify specific recipients that you want to receive this. So do you want this to go to your sales rep, to your operations manager? So think about different roles like that. We've added those. And then you can also add individual recipients as well. So maybe there's individual people that you want to get notified if the crew is late as well. And then you'll see grace period, which is kind of the operative part of this. So this is in increments of 5 minutes, five all the way up to 30 minutes. And you can do multiple as well. You can set up a notification to go out at 5 minutes, if they're 5 minutes late, and then again, if they're 20 minutes late. But what this is essentially doing is saying, you know, hello, contact, if this, you know, if it, hey, branch manager, your crew was supposed to perform this service at this property at this time. They're now 15 minutes late. You're going to want to reach out to the crew leader and to the customer. And if you go to the next slide, I think we have an example of this as well. Yep. So again, just an example of some of the internal notifications features we are rolling out as well, to help kind of streamline operations a little bit. And the last thing I'll talk about is notification logging. We did add a notification log to the admin page where you manage notifications. So that's a different tab. We'll list out each transaction, right? Every time a notification goes out, it gets logged in there. Added a bunch of different filters based on those parameters that we've seen so far. And then we also added some hyperlinks too. So in the case that, you know, say for that absentee notification, you notice that a crew member is consistently being late, you can actually click on that crew member, and then it'll take you to their contact record, and we'll show you all of the absentee notifications that have been generated for that person. Similar to property, right? So if you look at this notification log for this property, you can actually click on the property name It'll take you to the property page. And then on the property page, we have a notification log too. So that system notification log in the notification section is kind of the parent, right? That's the central repository for all of our notifications. But then we've also added it on the property as well as the contact record.
Yeah. And I think a key use case on the property one is somebody calls in and says, hey, I didn't get a appointment or excuse me, a visit reminder, and your crew's out here doing work. I wasn't expecting it. Somebody in the office that's taking that phone call can go to the property and quickly check this notification log and see why Mrs. Jones may have not gotten the SMS notification because she maybe isn't opted in. She didn't reply start or what have you, but trying to handle those types of situations where somebody's calling in and saying, hey, I was expecting to get a notification, email or SMS, and I didn't. Can you check into it? So we've tried to streamline that and make that as easy as possible to do from the property. And then as we kind of like finish up here, so customer notifications, some email best practices and tips, like John was mentioning, use the tokens. You can personalize the email address or the email design and kind of the feel of it using those tokens. Try to use simple, straightforward language. Avoid kind of technical industry specific jargon that the layperson may not be able to relate to or understand. Make sure it's in their language and it's something that they're going to be able to easily comprehend. And then deliver the right information at the right time with instant versus digest. So I think John touched on it. Commercial versus residential, very different use cases and ways that probably people want to ingest, especially property managers on the commercial side or people that are managing properties or multiple properties that are being serviced by your company and getting, you know, 30 to 40 different services completed throughout the week or throughout the day. They don't want 30 or 40 notifications. They want one kind of roll-up digest that will contain all of that information. Express appreciation probably just goes without saying anything. We talked about upselling, cross-selling, offer additional services, you know, start talking about signing up early for your fall service in the spring by, you know, attracting some sort of discount by signing up early. But while these are transactional, like I mentioned, you can include promotional type information in there to try to use it as a upselling or cross-selling vehicle. And then make the most of the footer on there. I just put an image in there of kind of social links, but you can get creative with what you're trying to kind of promote or advertise through your signature on the email as well by using some of the HTML and trying to get visitors to do more with less. Something that's not here is reviews. Maybe you put some links to some reviews, trying to promote people to leave reviews of how your services are being delivered. Switching gears to SMS here, best practices and tips, opt in. Just make sure that you are as cautious as you can be in terms of opting people in and making sure that they're giving you the consent to check that box in Aspire. Long term, we'll talk about how people will manage these on their own on the next slide or two here. But for now, just be as diligent as you can be in the opt in. I will say with the way that we implemented this, each Aspire customer has their own system-wide toll-free number. And we did that because we didn't want sharing of numbers, et cetera, more so from the case of like, not so much for the case of like brand protection, but also making sure that if we have a client that's using Aspire and SMS notifications and they go rogue and do something, the way that we've implemented this, only their toll-free number would be impacted. None of the other Aspire toll-free numbers or clients would be impacted. So that's another thing to call out there, that your toll-free number is isolated from what all other Aspire clients are doing. So you are kind of in control of your destiny with how you roll this out. Keep it short and sweet. You're limited on text. The one thing that I want to make sure, so typically one message is going to be, you know, I think you're going to be limited to one message. Typically most SMS messaging applications, we've actually allowed you to send up to two messages. So you can have more content, just knowing that you might have to create or using the tokens and some of the information you want to communicate. We didn't want to limit you to just one message. So we've actually opened it up to two. And again, we're taking that cost. Each message, they call it a segment. Each message segment costs the same amount of money to send. So we're happy to do that though, to make sure that you're able to communicate what you need to communicate to your clients. So using call to action, provide next steps. So with a visit reminder, especially, make sure you're communicating what needs to happen before you arrive. If there's things that they need to do, you know, lock up the dogs, make sure they left the, you know, the garage door code or left something, the key or the gate open, so you're able to access if you need to do some irrigation work or you need to get into the property. Make sure you're communicating those next steps in the messaging to try to, you know, make sure that when you do arrive to do the work, it's a smooth and efficient process. And then think about the time of work being complete. So a lot of those different parameters that John was talking about, make sure you think through those different use cases with SMS. A lot of snow work coming out of snow season, and it may not be out of snow season in Illinois. We just had some snow last week. So, but a lot of times that work's being completed overnight. So you may not want to set your snow division or your snow services to be sending SMS immediately when work tickets are complete, because you could get some angry clients at 2 or 3 in the morning that are getting a bunch of notifications. So make sure you think through that and those parameters. And then just recapping here, email, SMS, the opt-in status, emails, again, easier to opt-in. Delivery speed, we have the digest options, we have immediate, we have the grace period now with SMS, which we'll continue to build upon. Directional, email does provide that two-way communication where if somebody does want to reply, you can kind of control where their reply is going to go to and turn it into a two-way conversation. SMS today is one way. Tokens, the email tokens, when you go to check those out, are more robust, expansive, more options because you have more room to produce content. SMS, the tokens you have choices of are limited compared to email. And some of the tokens we actually force a truncate on that. So there's a little test button when you're creating your notifications, which will actually allow you to type in a work ticket number and actually see live data produced in the token. So you can kind of see what a notification will look like before you roll out this as a campaign. Character limit we talked about. So usually, you know, on the SMS side, you're going to be limited to about 180 characters. If it's one message, we've opened it up to allow you to send up to 360 characters. Email, you're obviously unlimited in terms of what you do. And then design, you know, you're going to get that plain text experience with SMS and then HTML with email. So if we take a moment to look into the future, what does the future hold for Aspire Notifications? First bullet point there, we want to integrate notifications into the entire kind of customer journey once they've agreed to a transaction or a partnership with you relationship. So what are the next most important customer notifications? I think Ben's going to prompt you guys with a poll here. We obviously would love to keep building this thing out, and we would love to have more notifications today. But the good thing is we have the infrastructure. We've done all of the hard work to get the support behind the scenes built up for this functionality. So adding individual triggers is a much smaller, easier effort for us to try to incorporate. So we're just trying to identify what are the next most important ones for both email and SMS and make sure that we continue to deliver what is of value to you to make sure that you're delivering that experience to your clients. So we'll give it a minute here to see what responses we get. Are we looking, Ben? We getting some responses?
Yes.
Cool. I'm going to move on and then we can come back to it once you've had a chance to look at the responses there. So I wanted to talk to you about promotional email and SMS because I know I referenced the difference between transactional and promotional. So our plans for handling promotional email and SMS in the future is going to be integrating with a product our parent company ServiceTitan has coming out here this year called Marketing Pro, where we will be able to hook up our Aspire data or your Aspire data to Marketing Pro and essentially feed it all of your data. And then through Marketing Pro, you'll be able to set up some automated campaigns or send one-time campaigns using your Aspire data. So think of it as a MailChimp or Constant Contact system that's basically directly integrated with Aspire, able to set up campaigns around opportunities, around estimates, around those kind of key pre-transactional things where you're trying to follow up or trying to send out specific promotional emails for seasonal things coming up, or maybe it's just newsletters. So email and SMS are part of that vision and plan. More to come on that, but that is something that's in our docket for this year. Another part of that will be direct mail, where you'd be actually be able to order postcards and do some direct mail campaigns through that as well, using Aspire data. And then we will also be able to pull some data back from Marketing Pro into Aspire, so you can kind of understand what emails people might be reading, what emails they're being sent. So you're able to kind of see that customer journey in Aspire and not have to go into Marketing Pro. It looks like we got our poll results. Okay. Looks like we got some close ones there on it. So it looks like visit reminder was number one, followed by a visit has been scheduled with email. And then SMS, looks like the visit reminder opening up to a day before or more than a day before is the most important one, followed by visit has been scheduled. So, oh, I'm sorry. SMS post-visit follow-up was the top one. My apologies. So post-visit follow-up and then visit reminder. Okay, cool. That makes sense. Appreciate everybody's insight there. That data is super valuable. Continuing on here, looking into the future, customer portal redesign. So part of our roadmap plans over the next 12 months or so is to redesign our customer portal. So we've gotten a lot of questions, feedback about how to include pictures or include attachments with some of the notifications. Including attachments with email is a possibility, but it's kind of like legacy technology with the way PDFs and attachments and the kind of design and trying to get things to fit into a PDF. It's just much more difficult than if we're able to host information in this redesign portal where you'd have information like those photos or attachments or things that you're trying to communicate, where the email or SMS is more about the notification that, hey, something happened, and include a hyperlink where they're going to be redirected to somewhere on this portal where responsive page, if they're on their phone, easier to digest than a PDF and just easier to format and do some of those things. So long-term, we would want to host as much of that information via the web on that customer portal. But definitely hear the reasons and know it's something that people are wanting. So I want to make sure we cover kind of what we're planning for that today. And then long-term speaking, we did choose Bandwidth, which John mentioned earlier, as our SMS provider. So they do provide the potential to do two-way messaging where clients could respond. And then inside of Aspire per se, you'd actually have a notification that pops up that, hey, somebody responded to one of your SMSs, and actually be able to respond directly back to them through Aspire via SMS. So that is a potential, just an idea at this point. But when I talked about choosing the right provider, that was one of the big reasons that they do support two-way messaging. So we want to make sure that we keep that kind of in our wheelhouse going forward. So we'll end here with some Q&A, which I'll take a look through. I don't know if Ben or John have anything right off the bat, but there's also some links here just in terms of the compliance we talked about. If you want, if you're in an insomniac and looking for something to put you to sleep, feel free to read the compliance links there. They will probably put you to sleep. And Aspire side, some helpful links there on taking advantage or getting into more specifics around some of the knowledge base and user guide articles that we have. So I'm going to hop over. One question about changing toll-free number to a local number, not as of today. There are some different regulations and policies that apply to local numbers versus toll-free numbers. So toll-free numbers actually have the least stringent rules around SMS for both promotional and transactional. So that's why we chose a toll-free number. Looking through the rest here. Is there a way to resend the SMS opt-in if the customer can't find the message? Correct. You can go in and basically uncheck the SMS box, save it, and then go back into that same modal and recheck it, and it'll resend the SMS for you. Looks like we answered a couple of them. Is it considered canceled when the visit is removed from the schedule board? Correct. Copy of the recording we will be sending out. How would they sign up for additional promotional services? Great question. Today, so that would probably consist of doing a little bit of work outside of Aspire or having some sort of URL maybe on your website where you're advertising those additional promotional services or allowing them to sign up through the website potentially, where you can include that hyperlink in the email template or SMS templates. And that would be something customer portal, when we talk about the redesign, that potentially is part of that scope where you can host additional kind of promotional marketing pages inside of the customer portal. And then obviously, once we have those things more built out and integrated, I think long-term there would be a potential to automatically have people take agreements or sign up for those things directly through the portal. So for a more seamless experience. The tokens. So there's an article link in here for the tokens, available tokens for SMS and email. Somebody was asking about a list of those. And then it looks like we got some other feature feedback that we'll want to follow up individually here as we come up on time. I know we're going over our 45-minute time that we were trying to hold to. So I sincerely appreciate everyone taking the time to give us some questions, give us some feedback. If we didn't get to your question or your feedback verbally here, we'll make sure John or I follow up outside of this webinar. So look for a follow-up there. And we look forward to you guys taking advantage of these notifications and continuing to build this out, and appreciate your loyalty to Aspire. And so on behalf of Ben and John, I want to thank you for your time. Anything from you, Ben?
No, thank you so much, Matt. Thank you so much, John. Look forward to next time.
Awesome. Thanks, everyone. Have a great day.